Professor Padikkal, you can start now.
Okay, thank you. Very good evening. Welcome to all. Today, we have one of the most suitable scholar to speak to us in this international webinar on translation studies across frontiers. Professor Rita Kothari is not only a very reputed teacher of English, but also one who has worked on translation without borders. She has documented and studied the cultural translation that happens between cultures, national borders, regions, religions, and communities. Especially, she has translated and published stories related to the memories of people of Sindh region and stories of the partition of India. Rita Kothari is a professor of English at the Ashoka University, a distinguished translator, and actually a very prolific writer. She is internationally known for books such as Translating India, The Cultural Politics of English, and A Multilingual Nation. Also, Chutneyfying English, Decentering Translation Studies, and her translations of note include Angaliyat, The Stepchild from Gujarati, Unbordered Memories from English, and The Pathan Trilogy by K.M. Munshi. Her work on partition and borders intervene to bring the unusual Sindhi experience in books such as The Burden of Refuge and The Study of Indo-Pak Border Region in Memories and Movements. Kothari is a multilingual scholar, and her translation interest is manifest in the way she moves between various languages through research and pedagogy. She also writes extensively on language politics, partition, and literary and social traditions of Gujarat and Sindh and Hindi cinema. With these words, I very warmly welcome Professor Rita Kothari and request her to deliver her lecture on translation and gender. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Shivram, and thank you all for coming. I also see very old friends here, and not old chronologically, but old in just my association with them. I see Professor Harish Trivedi, I see G.J.V. Prasad, so, and I see some students whom I've taught in the past and in present. So that's really generous of you to do that. I think before I kind of begin my talk, I want to kind of say that this is really ongoing work, right? It is very much work in progress, and you'll be able to see the roughness of it. But the reason why I want to present this work is also because I need feedback. This is probably one of the chapters in a book that I'm trying to write, which examines questions of language translation, but more importantly, that also focuses upon experience, and that sort of looks at that when we talk of untranslatability, or when we talk of incommensurability between context or text and languages and situations, does what escapes us, the residual matter, the leftover, is that actually one of experience? So in that regard, I'm kind of urging us to look closely at language, and not only at literary language, but also everyday utterances, homilies, completely harmless, everyday, quotidian forms of communication. And so I'm sort of shifting attention somewhat from the idea of feminist translator as the one who woman handles a text, and the kinds of work that has been going on in the Anglo-American and Canadian academy for a while. But instead, I'm actually looking at the South Asian more multilingual matrix, and to see where, how do we locate what is being said of us? And how do we hear it? What is it actually to kind of spend time on the contours of language? What is it to listen, for instance? Right. So the project itself is not very ambitious. It is more of a gaze, and it is an observation, and it is one of dwelling and staying with something rather than a sharply pointed out some polemical argument. So the chapter or the paper is called The Elsewhere of Gender in Translation. And to me, elsewhere helps me to think of displacing the questions of gender and translation from the usual place, from the usual sort of site where it gets looked at. On the face of it, what can gender and translation have in common? Nothing really. The former is about everything, and the latter, a mere linguistic activity of transferring one set of things from one language into another. As people remind us, translation is as secondary as the woman herself. What does it take to transfer meanings? It's a quiet in-house activity that makes some people happy and brings them a little something, joy, money, whatever. It's a hobby, not a real job that man of the house does. The real thing is the original. Translation is a mere copy of that, a parasite that depends on it. While not entirely false, these views don't help us open questions. In fact, they close them. The hegemonic symmetry is too neat and non-generative by restricting itself to binaries of men and women and respective forms of labor. I'm hoping that this thinking aloud essay helps us go beyond this impasse, this stasis. On the basis of myriad examples in the essay, I hope to show that gender is the jaggedness in the bridge translation is meant to create. It is the rocky part of the bridge where you're likely to fall and sink. At best, you can become aware, and that alone should count for something. How do we then trace the tight embrace that language and gender create? I suggest we look at language hidden in plain sight, into the quotidian modes of everyday, in the domestic and in texts. I believe that we need a simultaneous gaze at both the spoken and unspoken, the linguistically available and implicit assumptions of gender. It is possible that in some cases of literary, textual, as well as everyday instances, the linguistic difference is marked, drawing attention to itself. Meanwhile, words are thrown at women in real life and in stories. And when women who translate also notice, they throw them back, bearing them of any euphemism. Feminist writers in Quebec, particularly, and starting in the late 1970s, a famous example in this regard goes like this in English: "This evening, I'm entering history without pulling up my skirt," by a traditional translator. "And this evening, I'm entering history without opening my legs," by a feminist translator. The latter, termed as a feminist mode of translating, lays bare, makes explicit what is implicit. It signals the repossession of the word by women and the naming of the life of the body as experienced by women. One may ask whether the latter is faithful, but the judgment rests upon the object to which women translators may be required to be faithful to: patriarchal language or the project at hand. From my point of view, Indian incorporation of theorization about gender and translation from both French Canadian and the Anglophone context remains restricted for three reasons. It is in the realm of professionally or consciously translating. It is in the realm of evidently and overtly linguistic translation, and it is in relation to texts understood in the most physical sense. In the South Asian context, translation is an integral part of both domestic and also the domestication in the use of everyday language. The multilingual rubric is useful to understand this, and the interactions with English also provide competing worldviews on gender. in a Kannada poem that I will show you briefly. Hari, can you show that? In a Kannada poem made available to me in English by Kamalakar Bhatt, the poet Lalita Siddhabasavaya addresses God and says, "We are translating you in all the languages of this earth simultaneously, everywhere in all the unpublished writings of all the mothers. A powerful image appears before my eyes, one that has no cultural or political relativism, but a universal phenomenon without a universal language. Its universalism is produced by its relation to an unseen power that drives all the women of the entire world to follow an unseen original, a scripted document. We could use women as a provisional category to expand it and include all forms of performativity and not only assigned female gender. At the same time, a distinct female body, a reproductive body, is important to the poet. For we are told in the next stanza, God, we don't know its script. Hari, can you just make sure you go to that slide? God, we don't know its script. In the caressing by our palms, in the tight folds of our arms, in the low cradle formed by our thighs, in our milk-filled breasts, prior to that, in the flesh and blood of our wombs, we keep translating you close to the source, committed to your motives. The bearing of the original is the task of the women translators, we are told. They sustain it in their wombs without possessing it fully. For they know they must continue to not be egoistic and claim full possession. They have it in the body, but not for keepsake. They must translate, but also keep close to the source. In this onerous task, they take upon themselves, they are the privileged ones, the chosen ones, undertaking God's agenda. Or are they, by being women, shortchanged and made to be of secondary assistance to a male God? Does maleness of God lie in the grammar, or rather in the nature of this relation by performance of power? It's also interesting to think that the mothers translate without knowing the script, as if to say that the translation is not the writ of literacy. Perhaps not knowing the script makes the translator stay close to the source, daring not to go astray. The last stanza of the poem recapitulates the question I asked earlier. Can we go to the next slide? If this is a privilege or non-consensual labor, and we are told, I think somewhat ironically, God, do not make us greedy. Alert us time and again against corrupting the original. Let us not ask for any gain from this translation. May all the rights remain with you. God, thank you for choosing only us as your translators. You can remove the slide. Only women could be chosen to translate, to take on the most important and trustworthy job. But only women could be told to do the most important job and stay within the boundaries of a text, the maryada or limits of a life. For only women and translators would be construed greedy if they asked for more. This poem raises very significant questions of translation, labor and gender, and especially the paradox that underlies prerogative and coercion. In doing this, the poem troubles the collapsing of marginality, both of women and translators. My interest lies, as I said before, in experience and language, and how they might produce sites of gender relations which are not in isolation from caste and class. The sites may or may not lie in texts or the assigned bodies and sex of the translators and authors, but ways in which language bears implicitness of gender, inviting us to read through translation what lies not just hidden, but it may actually be in plain sight. In doing so, I draw attention to vignettes from multilingual sites and hope to demonstrate that questions of gender and translation are before and beyond the paradigms of translation studies. I suggest that we hear as feminists. In that respect, if we were to go back to the poem we started with, the paradox of privilege and compulsion in the poem is of greater interest to me than the perception of reproduction as derivation. This essay grounds gender as a language affect and observes it through multiple sites of reading language, both as specific historically named languages and also language in its role of constructing gendered subjectivities. In doing this, it affects translation as a consequence, because we actually translate in some of the passages, but also as a form of understanding. The exercise helps in seeing the phrase gender and translation beyond the intertwining of marginality. Rather, it opens out everyday situations and literary examples to a scrutiny of a translation gaze. I'm presenting to you my first vignette. Anya Sumpayawahe, is my brother still sleeping? I was being asked by my father. Someone says speaker is invisible. Is that true?
No, ma'am.
Okay, so my first vignette, which is from Sindhi, it says, Anya Sumpayawahe, is my brother still sleeping? I was being asked by my father. The question had possibilities of a volcanic eruption. With heart drumming in my chest, I went to my brother's room. His anger was more physical, but back then I didn't know if the feeling of fear was different. I was supposed to return to my father and tell him what he already suspected. He's about to get up, it looks like, I replied, in Sindhi, of course. By not lying, I had been truthful to my father, but by hoping that my brother would wake up soon, I was giving him a chance to do so before all hell broke loose. This was not just a usual instance, but a deeply experienced schism in my house between my father and brother. My bhabhi, my mother, me and my sisters watched with trepidation when their differences widened or shrunk, and what consequences that would have on us who waited and served. Puta, marda to gusso kanda ahin, my mother would remind me. Men do express anger. In fact, I just added express to what is more like men do make anger in Sindhi. English somehow made anger into a feeling that needs expression rather than an act the way my mother implied. My language carries these itchy scars. Alina Bazil reminds us of trauma underneath almost healed scabs. Where do we map the skin of language, she asks. Quite often, translation for hurting bodies like that of women is a reconfiguration of these wounds on the body of language. We bear different languages in our bodies. Sindhi, the language my mother taught me, is the language in which men's and women's roles were normalized the most. It is the language of guilt, one in which I learned the duties of a daughter-in-law to be. Sasasaiya nagalai boa, you can't speak like this with your mother-in-law. Or chokri vaat khole to ghar kharab thi mane. When a woman is loose-tongued, she brings the entire house down. I refuse to translate this into English, into my life, for English is the language of that judgment. Mediating between Sindhi and English is Gujarati, a source language of the texts I work with, the kitchen language of my joint family, but rife with power relations of a different kind. In the state of Gujarat and a family with Gujarati in-laws, my mother tongue, Sindhi, remains in the same place inside me. It was to Gujarati I first turned, learned, translated into English, and established legitimacy. I moved from a mother tongue to husband tongue, from a stateless minority language to the official language of the state, seamlessly assimilating into a more hegemonic context. My food was renamed so that Basaraji Koki became Kandana Thepla to help the Gujarati household appreciate my difference on their own terms. This politics of language and translation between unequal segments of a joint family was an early insight into the subject. Sindhi was a strange language, what with its origins in a hoary Pakistan and its association with people who seemed difficult to fit into Gujarati Vaishnav's notion of a normal Hindu. The effort to translate this non-textuality was enormous and seemed unnecessary for a while. Hence, Gujarati became my language of source, from which emanated new legitimate meanings. The fact that I was a daughter-in-law entering into a house with a minority language positioned both me and my language in specific ways, relegating both of us to a private, unspoken world. This is one of the most fundamental dyads of translation, a minoritization of expression produced through a collusion of the self, body, and language. Meanwhile, by being Gujarati's outsider, I heard its outsideredness most strongly. And words like those people, eloko, and many other forms of non-named references to the poor, the illiterate, the Dalits, the Muslims, made themselves heard to me. It is in my language matrix that a language of normalizing otherness, just as Sindhi became a language of normalizing patriarchy. Sindhi drew boundaries for me and my sisters. It was a language of borders. I would learn later, though, that it was a trans-border language spoken here and there in India and in Pakistan. It was an opening out language then, making me feel more welcome in Karachi, where I could flaunt a language I had hidden in Gujarat. It found hospitality, not in its close neighbor Gujarati, but its splintered self in Pakistan. Compulsively mediating and translating, I heard and reproduced meanings from both sides of the border. The everyday patriarchy of the language got suspended for a while. I had become an adult who could curate parts of the language I liked. It now stays within me as a language that both opens out and closes, depending on the nature of my subject position. One has made me want to ignore and not translate. The other side to the language has made me warm up to it as a memory of pre-partition days. Sindhi also became my site of resistance to Gujarati, my husband tongue, my in-laws tongue, and language of the state that divides the world between Hindus and Muslims, between vegetarians and non-vegetarians. Meanwhile, Gujarati adopted me by ignoring my Sindhiness, and of course I collaborated in that amnesia for many years. Translating from Gujarati consolidated that position. It became an evidence of my good behavior to in-laws and their language. The gendered perception of my good behavior came to play upon around the text, hence the gendered elsewhere. Am I going very fast? Can I have somebody telling me, Rindan?
No, ma'am, it's perfectly okay.
So I'm presenting now another vignette. And once again, this is, as I said, from an everyday, very domestic context. So I'm doing very gharelu things today. Jeni daal bagdi, eno daaro bagdeo. If your daal is ruined, so is your day, I was told. The tuver or tur dal of an upper caste Gujarati family, sweet and filled with kokum and peanuts and khajur, the kind that is served in a vara as in a community meal. I was being indoctrinated into the Gujarati family. Amne daal vagar to chalej nahi, my mother-in-law said. The cooker would be filled with dal in the morning, and as I woke up to that whistle, I knew that the script for my life was written already. I was scripted to have dal twice a day, and only of one particular kind. Its life began before mine did. How dare I say I don't like the dal? Wasn't I grateful enough already to be accepted? A quasi-Muslim-like Sindhi person in a Gujarati household? My resistance, if any, existed in English, for the vocabulary to resist came only from my education in English. The Sindhi language in me reminded me my mother's voice, Putta, Savran mein sambhale haljain. Beta, be careful when you deal with the in-laws. And to have escaped my own illiterate, debt-ridden home? How dare I? And imagine such anger towards Dal? Har chokriya ke adjust karan gurje, my mother said. She had said this to all her daughters. Every girl should adjust. I focused on her peculiar English word and wondered what it was to aid and also to be just and let the Dal go. But it stayed in my life for years and years, only in that form, that pulse, and that sanctimonious authority. Amaj hoy, that's the way it is. But why not moong or masoor? Those Punjabi things are good for a variety, but we need this. I began removing jaggery from my portion, and then my portion from the food altogether. Cook different food for different people, exactly like my mother said. Be tankni dal apne saathe ch banaviye chhe. We cook dal for both meals. I heard apne. I would hear more of it each time and found my mind rebelling against this coercive inclusion. I would translate that into my head as amne, as in us people. Not you and I, but us people. Let me give you another example of elsewhereness. I will relate to you a text exchange between me and Abhijit Kothari, my partner. The two of us collaborated on translating a trilogy by K.M. Munshi, the Lord and Master of Gujarat, The Glory of Patern, and so on, which came out with Penguin in the last couple of years. K.M. Munshi, who's Gujarat's most popular, successful storyteller, and also the architect of the conceptual term about Gujarat's regional pride, Gujaratni Asmita. The text message is like this. Abhijit sends me a text message saying, Manjari died. I had tears in my eyes. And I'm replying back to him, who Manjari? And he says, Kak's Manjari, who else? Kak and Manjari romance characterizes, for many in Gujarat, the most predominant memory of Munshi's fiction. A relationship formed through a checkered history. This was perhaps the first instance of a stormy and romantic couplehood in Gujarati fiction. Hence, when Manjari died in the last novel of the trilogy, it evoked for many readers a highly charged response. At a time when we, Abhijit and I, would have been translating the chapter in which Manjari dies, I was away in Delhi, adjusting to a new life. Abhijit and I used to translate together. One of us would read out and suggest a rough translation, while the other keyed in, discussed possible options. It was difficult to say who did what, and a question that came up every time the book would be discussed on panels was, how did we divide the work between us? Had we admitted that he was better at scenes of actions, and I was at the more poetic and affective, we ran into the danger of stereotypes of masculine and feminine strengths of translation. And really speaking, it may well have to do with the kinds of reading we had done and internalized. Without stopping to think of these distinctive strengths, we moved on and almost completed 2.5 novels of the trilogy together. The text message reminded me how distant I felt from the woman protagonist whose death my male collaborator had conveyed. The distance can be explained by my physical distance from the text, and for some weeks, the project of translating Munshi, which Abhijit was carrying out valiantly in my absence. Or did he experience Kark's loss and was in fact relating to the husband, even if the sentiment was occasioned by the death of Manjari? I wish to mark this moment through this example as one that is not about a woman translator relating to a woman character, which, as you see, is not happening, or rather the affinity a male translator felt towards the woman character, which you do see is happening, the moment is to suggest how irrelevant it would be to start this discussion on translation by thinking of male-female binary or even bodies as a starting point. Our performed gender and its alloyed chemistries may have, would have, lent more complexity to our relation with the task of the of translation. However, its effects may not be manifest in the text, and perhaps we need not even look for them there. It seems to me that this relationality, rather than beginning and end points of texts and people, seek further reflection. So the question of what might be the relation between gender and translation may be less fruitful if focused upon how bodies are gendered. I suggest we explore different questions that fall under the arena than to assume a core that defines or resolves it. Thus, our being male and female translators with relation to a celebrated text by a celebrated male author with a strong woman character in it provided no easy symmetries of gender and identification. What got generated that day was my guilt at not doing, not only doing my share, but feeling so disconnected. Or was it guilt at being away from home? Did translation then become a proxy, as it usually does, a stand-in for something else? I hope to be able to explore this surrogacy in translation of being elsewhere. And before I move away from K.M. Munshi, I must also draw your attention to another instance, again outside the text, not in the activity of translation, but around its feminized labor. In two recent interviews in Gujarati, I was told, "Tame Munshi sahib ne translate karya, e Gujarat taraf tamari bahu moti service kehwai Rita Ben. You have translated Munshi sahib, and that's commendable service towards Gujarat," I was told by journalists. Not having heard these words or any word while translating a Dalit or women's writing, I was struck by being at the service of this powerful male writer. The use of the word service immediately invoked notions of translator's servitude to text, to tyrannical notions of the original, and to inflated egos of writers. We seldom think of gendered labor, the relation that we women translators have to the extolled male writers. Is the labor of translation gendered then? Is its syntax drawn from an imagery of service, servitude, and duty, like women's child labor, as such arduous work, but processed as duty? I asked myself what made this particular instance feel like I was cooking for Munshi, while the translation of Makwan's Dalit novel Angadiyat and women's writing did not feel like one. The feminization of my labor occurred elsewhere, in the perceived hierarchy, not in the nature of the text. Munshi's fiction, by being ideologically conservative, generated unease about my own role and politics in translating it. It did so by being a xenophobic text, and that was the unease that both Abhijit and I carried while also attending to its formative influence in Gujarat, and hence the need to bring that to discussion. Munshi's women are feisty, setting terms of engagement, and are perhaps the first set of women in the history of Gujarati literature to do so. That did not make me particularly identify with the women. Dalit and women's writing escaped the notice of Gujarati journalism and literary world, drawing neither appreciation nor censure, and the labor remained invisible rather than feminized. What is brought over once again is a dialectical relationship that both translation and gender are part of in the larger cultural and political structure, and the foregrounding of that relationship becomes evident in surprising and non-uniform ways, but almost always played out on the body of language. commitments to feminist and anti-caste modes require us to pay attention to utterances, see them for what they are, intentional, non-intentional, symbolic, normal, literary or literal, but textual and implicit, even when they appear obvious. In fact, especially when they appear obvious. How do we, for instance, think of the colloquial untranslatables such as khandan, karapu, izzat, words of honor, boundary, lineage, family that create an arsenal for female assigned bodies who transgress, overreach, carry desires held illegitimate by their caste and class? How does English interact with these languages, bringing the promise of agency and modernity? If we examine how English interacts with regional language on this issue, we notice two things. For instance, the common sense about and normalization of molestation, rape, discrimination is part of the linguistic repository in some of our languages. And so the terms I mentioned earlier, maryada, izzat, abru, karapu, which translate as chastity, boundaries, protocol, sustain unequal gender relations. The calling out, the legal terms are often in English. They draw from a transnational vocabulary of feminist discourse and are then translated into the bhashas. Thus, translation is both the object and mode of reading gender discourses. In that vein, I'm providing an excerpt from a story by Varsha Adalaja, a very acclaimed writer in Gujarat. The story, which I've recently translated for an anthology for Aleph, is called this, Naina Rasik Mehta. And I'm just giving you a small vignette. It is an interaction and memory. An upper-class Gujarati woman staying in a sea-facing apartment in South Bombay goes to a police station. She is haunted by instances of violence, both physical and linguistic, perpetrated upon her by her mother-in-law and husband. She's had enough. The police inspector and his minion speak Marathi. She responds in Gujarati. The banality of the interaction is something like this. Name, Naina, full name, Naina Rasik Mehta. Sarnamu, what? Address, where you stay, kuthe rehvanu? Jai Mahal, Marine Drive. Next slide, please. Wow, near the sea. Darya Samovar. Yes, Sahib, near the sea, Darya Same. Savant, this is that building, remember where we had gone for a theft case? What is its name now? Kai now? Seabird. Yes, first class building. Sahib, my complaint. 1 minute. Don't do ghai. Shanti teva. What's the rush? Thank you, Hari. That's fine. The Marathi inspector assumes that a woman from a good family, khandan, living in a sea-facing apartment would have come to complain about a servant. Language here performs class and gender relation more prominently. Caste is more explicit. And I'm quoting now from the story. The police officer returned to his desk. He yawned audibly as he sat down. He cracked his knuckles. Naina read his name on the uniform, S.P. Jadhav. Her tongue moistened her dry lips and she stood up, erect. Jadhav opened the complaint book, ruffled its pages. He took a pen in hand. All right, madam. So what time did the theft take place? Sahib, how many newspapers mention don't hire servants without doing some due diligence? You should find out, na, if they have any criminal records. Ask police stations. Sahib, listen to me. Do you have a photo? And tensa gawacha address? His village address? No need to worry. How much did you lose? Did you bring a list with you? Wonderful. You don't want to tell me? Look, I'm quite busy. She stammered. Sahib, there's been no theft. So why aren't you telling me, madam? You lost your Mangalsutra in a local train then. Is your dog missing? Some roadside Romeo Eve teased you. I'm a terror to those kinds, I'm telling you. Sahib, my husband hits me and my mother-in-law also with her voice choked. She had meant to fall into the arms of a Rasik and lose herself in fantasies of companionship. How did she then come to be in this condition? Jadhav put his pen down. His lips curled. Savant came and stood beside Jadhav. Jadhav, what is madam's complaint? Domestic violence, he replied in English. The English word makes it official. The homely advice that gave the inspector self-importance is not needed. A legal term in English reorients the nature of transaction. The naming English does of the phenomenon that the inspector saw as a mere inconvenience in the usual life of a woman takes the matter out of the domain of persuasion and condescending advice. It has affected the sociality of the entire interaction, almost as if someone had used a weapon in a perfectly normal situation. She becomes the third person, unpleasant, whining, petty. Then Inspector Jadhav says to his companion, Savant, you know how it is, this so-called domestic violence. The husband must be peeved about something, yelled maybe, and madam made a dash for the police station. She looked at both men with petrified eyes. Will they refuse to write her complaint? She immediately said, no, Sahib, that's not how it is. You must listen to me. Of course I'm listening to you. I am, he repeated in Marathi. How long have you been married? 7 years, but Savant spoke in an incredulous voice. 7 years, long period that is, and you suddenly rushed to file a complaint today. Did he suddenly become cruel? See, madam, you seem to be from a respectable family. Khandani ani sanskari ghar. You must be educated too, right? By doing this, you're jeopardizing family honor. Do you understand? Jadhav continued. But will you at least hear me out? Woman, you listen to me. Have you informed your family that you are coming to a police station? No. Bas then. It's not too late. Go home. Married life madhe sagda hote. All kinds of things happen. Utensils when next to each other will bang. You understood? What makes Naina so illegible to the language of law? The incommensurability is evident through utterances and homilies that the police inspector is used to dispensing. They are in his everyday language, which happens to be Marathi. It's possible that Naina Rasik Mehta, if she had registered a complaint in Gujarat, would be hearing phrases like "Ben gharma be vasan to khakhade," or "Badhu thae lagna jivan ma, ema dorta dorta fariyad nondhava na avanu hoy," which is basically what was earlier said in Marathi. This common sense, made through a domestic metaphor of utensils that will inevitably bang against each other, is neither about the intention of the speaker nor an accidental use of words. Words flow effortlessly, flattening out the individuated narrative, subsuming it all in an already understood meaning of life. Once again, language performs sociality before it can be noticed for sustaining the status quo. The boundary-making words such as family, khandan, have been thrown in casually, their associated meanings of restraint, adjustment, acceptance, understood to be a shared meaning. These are not the words the inspector would be using for a Dalit woman who would be seen as having even less legitimacy, but also one as having less to lose in terms of honor. I'm just going to drink water. I see many of you do it. Hari, the next poem, please. The address Sahib, which you heard Naina use for the police inspector, appears elsewhere in a Dalit poem. However, both the speaker and the addressee are unnamed. The perpetrators are unnamed, but they are recognizable by symbolic markers of caste. The violence upon the speaking body is conveyed like a banal event of daily life. Same people, same actions, and it is not a sudden episode of recognition or retribution. It is a poem, but rather accidentally in verse, what appears like a regular everyday business. This tone, this timelessness marks its difference from the moment of Me Too, it gestures itself to. The poem, so to speak, is called Me Too, an English phrase of a specific moment, of a specific class and caste, but used for a context outside the discourse of Me Too. Let's go to the next slide. I'm going to read out in Gujarati. You will be able to pick up 2-3 words. The idea is not to alienate you, but to include you. And I will be providing the English translation. Velli parode paikhanu pakhadva avuchu, ne roj koi yoro mane upadi jaye che avavru khune, mane jakdi le che jameen sato sat, mari upar savar thai jaye che suvar ni jem, mane kochya kare che. હું બેશુદ્ધ ના થઈ જઉં ત્યાં લગી મને કાંઈ યાદ નથી સાહેબ કદાચ થોડું યાદ છે તો બસ એટલું જ કે નેક્સ્ટ સ્લાઇડ પ્લીઝ એટલું જ કે એના શરીરે સૂતરના 3 તાંતડા જેવું હતું એના ગળે તુલસીની માળા જેવું હતું એના મોઢે વીંછીના આંકડા જેવી વાંકડિયા મૂછો જેવું હતું અને વાન ઉજળિયાત હતો એ હરે હરે જેવું કશું બબડતો હતો ઉતરીને એણે સીધી ગંગા ભણી ડોટ મૂકી. લેટ્સ લુક એટ ધ ઇંગ્લિશ ટ્રાન્સલેશન. યુ મે હેવ હર્ડ ધ વર્ડ તુલસી, જમીન, સુવર, મેબી. લેટ્સ લુક એટ ધીસ પોયમ. એવરી સિંગલ મોર્નિંગ આઈ કમ ટુ ડૂ ધ ટોયલેટ્સ એન્ડ એવરી ડે અ શેડો ડ્રેગ્સ મી અવે ટુ અ ડેસોલેટ કોર્નર. ઇટ પિન્સ મી ટાઇટલી ટુ ધ ગ્રાઉન્ડ. ઇટ ક્લાઇમ્સ અપોન મી લાઈક અ પિગ and picks on parts of my body until I have turned impure. You remember Beshud? Let's next slide. Sahib, I honestly don't remember. All I recall is this. Its body had the sacred thread, its neck a tulsi mala, its face a handlebar mustache, and its body was fair, upper caste-like. We used the word ujariyat in Gujarati, which means both fair and upper caste. It muttered something like hare hare and it got off my body and made a dash for the Ganga. Thank you. We can exit slides now. The poem is by Nirav Patel. As I said, it's called Me Too. At the first instance, I read this as an undocumented sexual molestation of a Dalit woman, which it may well be. Really speaking, the Gujarati does not provide a gendered pronoun for the speaker. It provides its caste markers more clearly. Firstly, through occupation of a toilet cleaner or night soil carrier. Then there are caste markers of the body or the shadow that rapes, mutilates, makes impure the speaker, and then makes a dash for the holy waters of Ganga, as if it, right? There is no he or she in the poem, neither for the speaker nor for the shadow, as if it was made impure. It is easy and tempting and fully legitimate to read the speaker's body as that of a woman and an upper caste male as one of a man. And yet the only gendered address is Sahib, who's being told of this continuous, everyday, invisible to the world form of rape. Who is Sahib? A male police officer? Clearly a figure of authority to whom this is being told. Is this a form of complaint? The first reference of caste emerges through the speaker's occupation, as I said earlier, as one who cleans toilets at the crack of dawn, road savari. The shadow, or what is oro in Gujarati, that rapes the speaker acquires markers of caste in the second stanza. The sacred thread, ene sutar na tantala jevu kain periyutu, right? It is a sacred thread which points to it being a Brahmin. The tulsi mala, a Vaishnav. And the handlebar mustache, male and Kshatriya. These metonymic references to the three upper castes collapse into one person to make for his membership in an Ujjaliyat, or fair, as I mentioned earlier, fair skin upper caste, also embraces allusion to class. Inserting the pronoun she constructs for us an unremittingly familiar situation of a Dalit female body that is fed upon by a male body. And considering the poem is called hashtag Me Too, it is only natural to reproduce those terms and set them up in opposition to indignation of upper class and upper caste women at their sexual exploitation. On the other hand, withholding the pronoun and withholding gender makes the poem a structural symbol so that all upper castes collaborate through different layers of society to keep the Dalit pinned to the ground. Any translation discussion around the poem would dwell on the difficulty of the implicit markers of caste, and the meaning of the poem would be confined to the oppression of Dalit women at the hands of upper caste men. In doing so, there may also be an assumption that the English title of the poem, Me Too, moves smoothly between Gujarati and English. Generally speaking, we view translation acquiring its legitimacy from linguistic difference, not sameness. However, it is precisely the sameness that inheres many political signals of this poem. And ironically, that would seem not in need of translation. The campaign hashtag MeToo that gripped the world of the media, arts and politics was rehearsed in English, enacted on social media, and was produced by and addressed to situations of the urban privileged. By naming a relentless situation of a Dalit woman that can neither name nor shame, Patel points out to the irony of its ever-present banality in the lives of some. He draws attention to the amnesia regarding bodies of Dalits and the enshrining of the upper caste body in the Me Too campaign. Gender, caste, language come together in this poem in a way that complicates the assumed syntax of translation, which is not about finding equivalences between languages, but between the unspoken violence in the Dalit universe and the speaking out by privileged women. The poem is also a harsh reminder of the fact that the phenomenon has now come to be named, which particularly in the case of Dalit women is relentlessly continuous and centuries old. So the English word is not translated into Gujarati. In fact, sometimes words exist in new coinages too. For instance, languages have been forced to coin new Indian words, forms of words such as dushkarma for molestation. Someone said to me, pehla apne chhedkhani kehta. You know, earlier we used to call it eavesdropping, but now we call it dushkarma. The equivalence between sexual molestation and dushkarma, which is more like an evil or wicked action, is far from perfect. And yet the term has been scaled up from eve teasing, an innocuous little act of the kind that Krishna, the god, was known to have been doing with the gopis, the maidens. Why this word? I asked a senior journalist. I believe it's the influence of Hindi media, he said. By this, the journalist was referring to the way the Hindi word had entered into the lexicon of Gujarati journalism. The trace of a borrowed language irked him clearly, as did the hegemony of Hindi journalism. The root question that Gujarati journalism could have found a word that created a better equivalence did not come up, in his mind at least. What is also interesting is that what would that endeavor have led to? Coinage of another word that also stuck out, as things do when newness enters the world. How are we to read these inadequacies and excesses of words, slippage of a residual intention to make it milder than sexual molestation, or to externalize the unacceptable and attribute it to a non-native origin? Is that a problem of language, culture, gender, or translation? For instance, at the time of Me Too, a host of Gujarati articles responded to the moment of anger and awakening among women who called out their sexual predators from immediate and sometimes former past, only to end those articles to rest upon generalities of understanding, fellow feeling, and excesses of overreaction. The vocabulary stayed within the Gujarati text reluctantly, as it were, alien and unwanted, with its origins assumed to be elsewhere, Delhi, US, or at any rate, English language. Me too karwa jaiye, to half the population will vanish only. Whom are we going to live with? An elderly person in my family said that if we keep doing me too, whom will we live with? The language of assertion had seemed to this person clearly as a language of pickiness, of wanting to eliminate most of humanity, and dignity for self had translated for her as a desire for genocide of well-meaning people. The combinations of me and too must have appeared particularly selfish, not suggesting that sexual abuse happened to me as well, but that I too will demand attention, or I too want it. Give attention to me too. The vocabulary of feminism, as perhaps that of an individual self, is the outcome of modern subjecthood. This is not to say that it did not exist in pre-modern India, but perhaps its forms remain illegible to us, demanding therefore translation both from English, or retaining English as in Me Too, on, and in any case translation of pre-modern frameworks to suit more contemporary needs is yet to be done. Oh, so now translation can also be feminist, a wise friend remarked bemusedly when I mentioned I had to write an essay on the relationship between gender and translation. I was arrested by now. It was not merely an anodyne adverbial, but an impatient temporal marker. Never-ending evidence of women's greed. The admission of victimhood turned into a claim of attention, another form of Me Too. So this reflective essay has grappled with various forms of untranslatability, lurking memories that outlived the text, for instance, the adoption and resistance of Me Too in Gujarati, a coercive entry into an unwilling language or society, or a common sense in Indian languages that resist the English, the language of law, of naming and blaming, affiliations to patriarchy that are manifest in languages we embrace and resist, and so on. The essay attempted to create an archive out of our surroundings, experiences that do not make to translation theory, multilingual lives within whose folds lie some of the most intricate lessons of gender and translation. In doing so, my attempt has also been to carve a more local, rooted, and grounds-up approach to questions of translation theory in India, not one where the engagement begins and ends with definable, institutionally named translators and texts, but one in which we observe, as feminist translators, that language is the first institution of patriarchy, and that any act of translation must begin by seeing language not as a source, but as a system of signs and a living thing that requires paying attention to. To sum up, the gendered politics of translation is complex and elusive. It resides neither at the translator nor the text end of things. It is generated in all these forms of relationality and manifest in both overt and covert ways. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Rita Kothari, for this brilliant speech. I think that this lecture has addressed complex and elusive nature of gender in translation, as well as gendered translation. This paper has also demonstrated the crisscross interaction between Sindhi and Gujarati language. Taking a cue from your personal memoir, by connecting texts, art forms, ideas, and languages, demonstrating a few translations, you analyzed, coarsened, shaped, and created flows and fluidity of gender in translation. So I'm really thankful. I'm sure that the participants also enjoyed. Let me take some of the questions came to me. Okay, the first one is from Dr. Parveen Kumari, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Central University of Jammu. She has asked, when we do not know the original language of the text and it comes as translation, for example, English, the translated is taken as twice removed from reality, then how to look and study the language of the translated text?
We'll be reading out a few more questions, right?
Ma'am, we have received only two right now.
Okay. All right, I'll reply to Parveen Kumari then. Yeah,
ma'am.
I think you're right. I mean, I think the kind of small, what I call small work of language, right? Working, looking at language in lower cases, spending time, as I said, in and around it. It's something that I can do, or I do with languages that I know. I mean, would I be able to do it in languages I don't know? I'm sure I can't. So really speaking, my position is of somebody who's not situating this inquiry from a language, but who's situating this inquiry between, in my in-betweenness between languages, in what Rindon just referred to as crisscrossing. So I don't think it's possible to do it if you don't actually, because I think, you know, the thing about knowing the language is that you should also be able to hear its unspoken. Language is not only about what is said and what is spoken, but to be able to actually, so I mean, someone has said, for instance, how would you translate Suniye in the chat box here? And that's really the intimacy with language is also its pauses and its ellipses. And that would be difficult if you don't know the language. Yeah.
Ma'am, the next one is from Swati Dhada. Namaste, madam. I'm Swati Dhada, lecturer in English, and I'm doing my PhD in translation. Can you please help me with a perfect translation equivalent for the word Suniye, and also to the honorific usage of you?
Swati, if you are actually in the act of translating a text and you come across these instances, it's one thing. But if you are asking me generally speaking, I won't be able to simply give you an equivalent like that. But what I would suggest, if you are actually translating, and this is something that has helped me a lot, that contextually sometimes you can insert both the Hindi word and English for the first time and then just stay with the Hindi one. And readers would understand that this person refers to her husband as Suniye. So it's not, I think these are little operations that translators do within the text if they are important to them. Sometimes I have also, you are asking question even about the honorific usage of you. And of course, we all know that sometimes in unequal relations in a text, one person would be saying aap and the other person would be saying tu or tum. I have sometimes taken like a tiny, teeny weeny liberty and say adding a familiar you know, if that interaction was very necessary to me. So sometimes just adding a tiny apposite phrase can help you if you are translating text, so to speak.
The next one is from Shyamola. In Nirav Patel's poem, the perpetrator is clearly male, though the pronoun used is it. Is that an attempt to reduce the upper caste man to a thing?
That's a very interesting question. Yeah, I mean, one could look at it that way. I kind of first saw it, as I said, as male and as woman. And then I felt actually sort of it deepened it much more for me when I also thought of it as a structural form of violence, not only as one more instance, but you're right. I mean, he would be definitely implied. And I'm ambivalent about whether the right thing to do is to actually sort of ask the author or anything like that. Nirav Bhai is no more. And unfortunately, I haven't had this conversation with him. But yeah, I'm sure you're right. It is.
Thank you, ma'am. The next one is from Himanshu. In the process of translating culture at literal and literary, for example, routine life from Sindhi to Gujarati and vice versa, is being a female translator an aid or a hindrance?
Yeah. How do I say this? I mean, this is almost like answering whether by hearing what I hear and by the fact that words preoccupy me, whether that has produced happiness or unhappiness for me. I think some lack of attention and some amnesia would have made me happier, but it would have also made me, I think, a researcher that is slightly tone deaf. So I don't know.
Okay, ma'am. The last one, as I can see on the Zoom chat box, Rajanandini Shaw has asked you a comment to add to the closing. Language is the instrument of patriarchy and not just an institution for itself. What is your take?
Well, it is both. I mean, when I said language is the first institution of patriarchy, I think my emphasis was coming from the fact that let's not constantly obsess over whether this is a male translator or a female translator. I was basically shifting attention away from gendered bodies to the idea of languages. But the fact that hegemony is sustained by both its institutions and it also deploys language to instrumentalize, I think that sort of goes without saying, doesn't it?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, Professor Daniel Costa Cruz from Brazil asked you that, dear Professor Rita Kothari, about the trilogy you said came out recently by Penguin, I understood you did with a man. So could you comment on the work of translation you did in terms of different genders working together? Were there any moments of disagreement on the basis of gender in relation to what was being translated?
No, the differences were many, very sharp, but they were actually about, you know, that previous question which was being asked to me, whether hearing it so much is an aid or is it a problem? I think the differences actually were not so much about the differences were sometimes about ideology and about, I find, for instance, I found Munshi normalizing Brahminhood in in sort of ways that I wasn't comfortable with. And my collaborator, he could also see it, and we've both written about it in our introduction. But he also had a tendency to kind of situate text in its period and to say that while Munshi may be writing in the 20th century, the text itself is of medieval India. So it was about reading practices, really.
Shadija wrote to you, I cannot agree more with Professor Kothari's point about translation capturing the unspoken. I think she perfectly illustrated this through her personal experiences across cultures and languages. Thank you so much for this fantastic talk that addressed so many things at once and made me rethink and re-examine many of the covert layers in our otherwise quote-unquote harmless, innocent day-to-day interactions. Thank you.
Thank you, Shadija.
The next one is from Ma'am Joshua M. Price. There is a recurrent sense of the implicit or unspoken or unsaid in your talk. Is this related to your thesis either of the elsewhere or of gender of translation?
Josh, can I see you? No, that's interesting, actually. It is actually related to, it is related to not only gender and translation. It is related to what I began with, that I'm interested in how language produces experience and whether what escapes translation is experience itself. So it comes from that preoccupation, Josh. It's a thread that will be running through many things that I'm sort of now currently looking at.
Ma'am, Tamasha Acharya on Facebook asked, if there are not many questions, ma'am, could you share some more instances while translating? Also, how much of fidelity to the text should be there? What about the temptations faced by the writer?
The thing is, every project I come to demands its own principles, its own ethics, and its own liberty. Really speaking, I'm not able to see whether I have something that applies blanket as a kind of a blanket norm to the translations I've done from, let's say, modern Gujarati poetry to short stories by women writers to Sindhi stories of partition to the Dalit novel and so forth. I'm not even sure I have been aware of what the measure of that fidelity is. But I will say this to you, that because I'm so interested in, you know, language shaping identities, which is such a big preoccupation with me, that sometimes if I've taken liberties, it has been actually in that arena to kind of insert every now and then a word from these other languages or phrase to signal what I thought was an important signal in the text. So really speaking, that is my penchant, in the sense it is my preoccupation. So I'll just give you an example, since you are asking for more. And this comes to mind because it is relatively recent. So that this novel by Ila Arab Mehta, it's called Vaad. And if you look it up, it's called Fence in English, about a Muslim girl who grows up in rural Gujarat. She's the first generation learner. And then she goes on to live in a bigger city, and she looks for a home in a mixed locality so that she's not relegated to a Muslim ghetto. So we are not going into that story right now, but just to give you an example. So as I said, she's a first generation learner. So she comes home every day from school and she tells her mother, ke ba aaje chhe na teacher mane aau shikhwadiu, like, you know, saying to her mother that our teacher said the earth is round. And then, you know, our teacher said that the world is this big. And Ba teacher said this, and Ba would hear this and smile while she's doing work at home, making cow dungs and so on. And Ba would say, teacher ka ye hachu, what the teacher says is true. But she uses the word hachu for sachu. Sachu is like sacha, right? But she, if even moving from sir to her marks your, it's an indexical position, which it's to be found more in dialectical inflections of Gujarati. If you're not saying sachu, you're saying hachu. So Ba would say hachu. And then daughter would teach her mother saying, Ba, that's not the way you should speak, because the daughter is now learning from Brahmin teachers in school. So she would say, this is not the way you should speak. Hachu ne gyanu, you should say sachu. Now this entire interaction about the mother speaking in one particular way, the daughter learning the language of people whose universe she wants to become a part of, is constantly played out in the text of how Fatima begins to learn Gujarati in the normal Gujarati. And I found it very interesting, because I think language is one of the first things you use when you are translating yourself into something else. You give up a language, you speak less Urdu, you don't show your Sindhi-ness, you don't show anything that will identify you as a particular person, or you embrace the way other people speak. And because this is important to me, I have done operations on through the text on this kind of interaction. Now, someone might say, and this goes to the question that someone is asking, translation and transcreation or fidelity or whatever. I've done what I've done. I mean, what name you want to give that to, that's entirely up to you. All I know is that, as Ramanujan said, you also have to be truthful to yourself, because that's where the ultimate benchmark is. It's not outside you. It's always inside you.
Ma'am, thank you. Thank you for this. Saima Khan Kadri from Sri Sri University asked you, are the lesbians made other than other when compared to gay translation? Because it is again the man and woman thing.
I would like a more elaboration of this, maybe an example or something.
Okay, ma'am. I hope that Saima will write to you. Okay, Dr. Kokila Kalekar from EFLU Hyderabad asked you, what was the difference between translating a Dalit or woman's writing and the one by K. Munshi that you have done?
Yeah. Okay. I will only recount to you that memory, Kokila, by affect, because really speaking, I think we bring different kinds of affect to the projects that we do. You see, the Dalit text, Angadiyat, first of all, it also came to me at a time when I was much younger. It's the first time that I was reading something like that. It came to me under very, very special circumstances. I was working at St. Xavier's College, and the peon there said, you read so much, Ben, tame amara vishay nathi vanchu, you haven't read about us. And he gave me the book Angadiyat. And Angadiyat is a very intense text, in the sense that it's got a plot, it's got high intensity melodrama. It's a very different kind of Dalit text. It's a novel. It's not an autobiography. I think what I experienced with Angadiyat was like something else altogether. And I think when I was doing women's writing, I've experienced a lot of ambivalence. Because when I did Speech and Silence, Literary Journeys by Gujarati Women, which Katha brought out, there was a certain template in my head. I was looking for an Ismat Chuktai. I was looking for a Kurutalin Haider. I was looking for a Kamla Das, and I couldn't find them. I found stories that seemed to me to be kind of muffled, genteel, and, you know, of a particular kind. And I wasn't particularly in love with what I was reading. But by then, I had sort of asked myself that, isn't this question worth asking? That why do translation anthologies have to be only about what we think are the best gems? That actually they can tell us about the universe that comes to be created in this very sort of well-meaning Hindu upper caste women who will take two steps forward, two steps backward. Ilaram Mehta also does it with friends. I think, in fact, they have provided to me a very deep insight, actually, into a certain kind of Gujarat. So Munshi, on the other hand, you know, he's much written about by social scientists. And really speaking, my decision to translate Munshi was actually to make this point about the fact that Munshi becomes this effective and this popular and occupies such a warm memory in the minds of the Gujarati reading public because of his fiction. And even Gujaratni Asmita becomes like an idea that's lodged in people's minds is entirely through the stunning stories that he tells. Now, really speaking, if those stories are not available in English, how do we even sort of talk about it? So Munshi for me was to extend that conversation about Gujarat, about the idea of Gujarat. So it wasn't coming from the other kinds of involvements that I told you, but it was also in some sense an enjoyable project because I was also for the first time doing it with my husband, and it was kind of good fun working together because it's a huge trilogy and it's written in a very racy style. There's a lot of drama happening. Every time you end the chapter, someone has suddenly appeared, a secret is out. Oh my God, now what's going to happen? So it was quite a trip actually. And I don't want to kind of undermine that.
The next one is from Pramukesh Nandan. Is there any way apart from silence in language and literature to translate amnesia caused by sexual violence? How do you achieve it?
As I keep saying again and again, one would have to look at examples, but I think it's very important to also kind of make sure that your language embodies it in the sense that it is not only, it's not a matter of skill, but it's also a matter of embodied sort of listening. And I think that has also been one of the running themes in what I'm working on right now. So sometimes when, you know, there are half trailing sentences, ellipses, use of sometimes such completely ordinary words for what would send shockwaves through our body, I think needs to be reproduced in that way. These are imaginings that as translators we do to say, you know, why would somebody do that? Because trauma does not come with a bang. It is almost like sipping sort of wormwood every day. So I think these are things that can inform our act of translating, but it's not a skill that can be imparted or learned or whatever.
Ma'am, I think I should end this question answer session with a comment from Daniel Costa Cruz. He has written on the comment box. He's from Federal University from Brazil. He has written that this lecture of Professor Rita Kothari was perfect with this series of webinars. So with this closing remark, I hand over to Professor Parikkal to give the vote of thanks. And thank you, Mom.
Thank you so much. Yeah, thank you.
It's amazing. Thank you, Rita, for that great lecture.
To draw upon your own abstract, okay? Thank you for that fascinating lecture on the complex and elusive nature of gender and the way it is generated in the relationality and manifest in both silence and language. I thank you very much. Since this is
the last session
of our webinar series, I will take a minute to thank all. I request you to bear with me, don't go. I thank all speakers, okay? We had a galaxy of speakers, in fact, who graciously agreed to speak and delivered marvelous lectures in this webinar. I thank Kalyani Samantrai, Rindam Kundu, and Hari Krishnan, and all the faculty and students of Faculty of Arts, Communication, and Indic Studies of Sri Sri University for joining us in this venture. I thank the head of the department, students and faculty of Center for Applied Linguistics and Translation Studies, University of Hyderabad. Especially I thank my student Abir Khatun, who has in fact chided me and instigated me to organize this particular seminar. I thank Lavanya Nemana, Renu El Zawarki, Priyanka Rachabatani, and Shashi Kumar for all their help. I thank the presidents, vice chancellors, pro vice chancellors, and all other officials of Sri Sri University and University of Hyderabad. I especially thank Arunjit and his team for the technical support that they have provided throughout the seminar. I thank all the translation studies enthusiasts who shared our publicity posters and videos, sometimes in hundreds, all over the world. I thank all participants from different parts of the world that include reputed professors, translation studies scholars, authors, and other academic and non-academic translation lovers. I don't know whether I should thank COVID-19, because due to that, I could actually bring all people, but I hope that our next session would be a face-to-face seminar. And thank you all for participating and making this international webinar on translation across cultures, translation studies across cultures, organized by Center for Applied Linguistics and Translation Studies and the Faculty of Arts, Communication, and Indic Studies, Sri Sri University, a grand success. Keep well, stay safe. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.